And now the Pascal will finish with the management part.
I don't need this. Actually, I will play. Okay, so to sum up, we have a strategy who tells you when you have a range, you have to act like that. You have the analyst, which is here to recognize if it's a range or if it's not a range. And then you have the trader who has to find the best spot to enter in this range and to manage the trade. But after, you have the risk management. So here you have four different, we call it equity curve, but let's call it curve. So we have four curves, two red and two blue. I have a question. The red and this blue, do you think that it's the same strategy? Do you think it's the same trader? You can reply, actually. Okay, I will pick up someone by hazard. So, do you think, you are in front of me, so. Do you think that the trader who has this result and the trader who has this result are using the same strategy, or they are different traders, or? Maybe the same, because I'm asking the question. Okay, but naturally you will maybe say, usually you have destroyed my thing, but you should have said, no, it's different. And I would have told you, wrong. No, actually it's exactly the same strategy. Actually, if you are very picky and if you look, it's, you know, it's always the same movement, like it's going up, it's going down, etc. So same strategy, same entry point, same way to manage the trade. There is absolutely no difference. Even here, no difference. Okay, so how it's possible that one is winning a lot, one is, let's say, not winning, and why one is a loser and one is a kind of winner? It's only because of the risk management. So risk management, it's how much you are risking every time you enter in a trade. It doesn't, it's not an obligation to always risk the same amount, because as you have maybe understood, you can't trade in the same way every time. There is opportunities that are more risky, opportunities which are less risky, and sometimes you are in what we can call a rush. So sometimes it happens, you end up to have 10, 20 trades winning in a row, and sometimes you are like in poker, in a tilt, you know, where you are just losing, losing, and losing. So every traders go through this kind of thing. So a good risk management strategy, it's to know how much to risk, so to be able to analyze and to qualify the risk of each of your position. And also it's to be able to recognize if you are in a, let's say, in a good trend in your result or no. So what's the difference between the two? We just have made an analysis on the results. So the blue, the two blue, it's a trading strategy which is very basic. You take two indicators that we're going to show you in 2 weeks that are called moving average. And every time those moving average are crossing, you buy or you sell. I mean, everybody can trade this way. Sometimes this strategy, I mean, this method works, sometimes it doesn't work. The thing that we have done is that, as you can see, this trader is losing for a very long period. Sometimes he's winning a bit. Here, sometimes he's winning, losing, winning, losing, winning. So what we can do, we can make an analysis on the result of the trader, and when we notice that he's in a bad condition, we don't change the strategy, but we're gonna risk less money. Because it means that your strategy is not doesn't fit the actual market condition, or maybe you are in a bad mood or whatever, so it's better to reduce your risk. So what we have done is just that every time the trader A was risking 100 euro, the trader B was risking 25 euro. When he was winning here, we were telling to the traders B to risk 200 euro. So what we have just done is super simple. We analyze the part when the trader is winning, the part when the trader is losing. Of course, we can't know it before it happened. We need few trades to know that the trader is losing or winning. And when we have this information, we reduce the risk or we multiply the risk. And this is why you end up to have this period where this trader has won a bit of money. Because he was winning, the other trader, we have multiplied by two his risk. So 200 euro per risk, 100 euro per risk. So of course he wins twice more. Then he loses a lot here because he's risking twice more. But after we have analyzed that he started to lose again. So we divide his risk per four. So finally, this drop has been divided by four. And we have the same result here. So this is how you can end up to be successful without changing your strategy. And this is an example that I wanted to show you to make you understand the ultra importance of risk management. Then you have the capital management. So first, you have to optimize your capital. So your capital is your tool. If tomorrow you become a super good trader, if you have no money to trade, it's pointless. So the first thing is that you need to acquire a capital. Not everybody was born with money. Not everybody has a legacy or whatever. So you need to find a way to optimize your capital. So here, you might say that it's not much trading, but you have to know how to spend less because it's easier to spend less than to win more. So you can, I don't know, if you have credits, you can find a way to group your credits. If you have, you know, an abundance with TV or internet or phone, you can group them. And the idea is that how you can optimize your personal finance so you can save even 20, 50, 100 euros per month, doesn't matter. Every small thing is a victory. So you optimize your way of living to end up to have more money to win. Then of course you save. So you have to save the money that you are sparing by optimizing your lifestyle and so on. And the savings, you're bad at, I don't know, you did that like, you don't know how to save. Okay, so then what you are saving, part of them, you keep it because it's super important. When you trade, you always need to have money aside because we don't know what can happen. And then the rest, you can invest in trading. And then reinvesting. So let's say that I like to make pyramids which are reverse. So here it's your salary. You know, so this is a sure source of income. It comes every month, so you didn't take that much risk to take your salary. Then let's say that this is another strategy to make revenue. So as example, it's your trading or your investments. Maybe you have invested in real estate, or maybe you are just trading on markets. So this is a more risky revenue source. So it means that the part of the money that you are making on your not risky revenue source have to be invested in the risky revenue source. And then here you have what is even more risky. So it can be a crazy trading strategy, it could be a casino. So me, what I used to do when I was younger, all the money that I was making in a week, 25% I was spending them in a blackjack and poker. Because it was fun and because you can win money and because it was more risky than trading. I've done the same with crypto. 30% of what I have won last year and in the company that we have, I have been reinvested in crypto before the big boom. So it was cool. I didn't sell high, so it's less cool, but still. So this is the idea. You have to reinvest. So super risky, less risky, medium risky, let's say, and not risky at all. Optimize, save, and reinvest. We are done for today. So next time, I know that today was a bit theoretical. So next time we're gonna go more into detail. So it will be maybe hard to follow for the one who doesn't have not a big focus, but we're gonna see how we can analyze the market. So it means that how we can recognize a trend from a flat market, how we can anticipate movement, what is the support and the resistance, so basically how the market is, what is the behavior of the market. We're gonna analyze cycles, and actually that's all. It's pretty enough. So it will be next Wednesday, same place. Maybe you want to add something?
We'll be here.
But you want to add something about something? Like. No, just no. So, one thing super important here to because you need to understand this, it's what you are saying. This is super important: qualifying and mapping the market. Because here, how you qualify? You have a market which doesn't move. Okay, this is a chart. Okay, point number one is done. So you have a range. Point number two: what is the context? Here, actually, okay, Here you know that, oh, it's in French. Here you know that there is a news. And it's even not the good news, but doesn't matter. So this is important because why it's important to know that there is a news? If the market doesn't move, it means that it's expecting something. If there is a news here, correlation, maybe the market is waiting the news. So it's super important to know what is the context. It's super important to know what is the chart and what people are doing. People are expecting the news, so it doesn't move, or people are anticipating a news. So for example, they are buying a lot and so on. Is there any crypto trader here? That's all? Well, okay. Okay, so as an example, if you are a crypto trader, you have seen that Coinbase, they have leaked information a few months ago about listing some tokens. So if you have seen the price of those tokens, they have risen up until the moment where Coinbase has listed them. So the market has anticipated the news. Okay, so sometimes the market anticipates, sometimes the market waits the news. It happens the same thing if you look at the pound. If you take a chart and if you open the pound, you can see, it looks like that. So here, let's say it's the date where happens the referendum, you know, that UK wants to leave our glorious United, Brexit. And before the referendum to happen, what was the context? Well, there was a political crisis in UK. There was people who were saying, "Ah, oh, but UK doesn't need Europe. Actually, it costs more money that it gives us advantage." So the context, was that there was a lot of doubt, and the markets were more were thinking, in a different way, because market didn't see this good, the Brexit, because it will cost a lot of money to the country, it will destroy a lot of work, it will be very complicated. So markets were afraid about the Brexit. And so the markets, when the market is worried, it falls, because market is emotion. It falls, it's worry. It goes up, it's happy. So the market was worried. The referendum happened. And what we have seen after, actually, is that there was a small drop. And finally, it went up because speculators realized that actually it was a bit exaggerated. Like, okay, maybe it will be bad, but not that bad. So they have behaved by selling a lot GBP. So when you were analyzing by this time, when you were analyzing GBP, you had to understand that. You had to understand that the market was overreacting. People were selling way, way, way too much. Because again, Brexit is not that bad. The context was a lot of doubt. So when you have doubt, it falls. And the chart was just a downtrend. To know this can help you in your strategy. Because by knowing that, you know that until the Brexit doesn't happen, so this is the date of the Brexit, you are pretty, pretty sure that the market will keep going down. So if you are here and you don't know what can happen after, you are pretty sure that the market will keep going down until the referendum. The same way that you are pretty sure that when you are here, the market will not move until you have the news. And when actually the Brexit happened, you could be pretty sure that because it was an overreaction, there are more probability that it can go up than goes down. And so this is why analysis and to understand those three things are super important. And that's all. And this we're going to see it anyway in 3 weeks. So here's the only things to understand is that in a range, you can enter here in the middle. You can enter here. You can enter there. Or you can enter at the lowest point. If you have common sense, you know that if you want to win a lot of money, you have to buy the lowest as possible. So when you have a range, the lowest point, it's easy, huh? It's this part. When you have a trend, the lowest point is a bit harder to analyze. Because when you are here, then what is the lowest point? So Valo told you that the best point is to buy or to sell after what we call a correction. So correction is this. You have a market going up. So when is the best time to buy? You have to wait that it goes a bit down. And here might be a good time to buy. But there is a lot of things to consider. Is it actually not risky to enter here? Is it not too late? All those considerations, you have to think about it when you enter in a trade. So that's all what I could add. So maybe now the best is to make some question and reply, question and answer. So it can be about what we have seen. It can be a more general stuff. So it's up to you.
So if you go back to the slide with the ECB growth rate decision, so if you wait for the news to come out, I suppose there will be a number of people who are trying to make a trade as soon as they know what the decision is. And I know of cases where you try to go into position and then the system will just not let it go in the first, say, 30 seconds to a minute after the decision. Is there anything you can do to protect yourself from
So if I understand, you say that when there is a big news, it's hard to enter the markets because there is too much movement and a lot of people want to enter at the same time.
Well, I basically had instances where I'm trying to execute the trade and then the system just says...
So here, if you... So first, to reply to our question, of course it happened. And some brokers have enough liquidity to be able to pass all your trades. If no, you're going to just have a larger, I will try to speak in a not technical way, so a larger fees, you know, like a spread or slippage. But the point of this was different, actually. It was to say, here we have a range, so we know that we can trade a range strategy until here. We didn't say that you can enter to trade. It's good if we can do it, but you know that it's hard in the news. No, the point it was to say, there is this news, so I'm pretty confident that I can do a range strategy until here. And the range strategy is to buy where there is the circle and to sell where we are here. So the thing is that when you are here, you can say it's more risky to buy than to buy here because I'm closer to the news. But maybe it's still doable. But because I'm closer to the news, here I will maybe risk only 25 euro, here 50 euro, and here it's impossible to know it was a range. So you adapt the risk according to this kind of thing. So this was the point about this thing. Okay, super. But yeah, if no, the news, no, actually the best is to enter here. Here it's for big money, people who are linked to the market. And for us, small guys, you can only enter here. And also because it's going too fast. I mean, honestly, it can happen in just 1 minute. So maybe you have something to add about it.
I want to add here on this exact example that it will be really hard to enter exactly when the news came out because of what you said, basically. But here you can enter where Pascal showed you, or if you decided. If you have a good range trading strategy and you are trading the range, you can always leave part of your positions open on the market. That way, for example, I'll just need the laser. Yeah. For example, if you have sold here, you get down here and you close your position, but you don't close the whole position. You close some percentage of it. This is more about risk management and trade management, which we'll talk a little bit more about in the future presentations, but just to give you an example. So you have all those positions. You have both buy and sell positions in this case of the range. That way you can anticipate the news and basically don't care where the news will go, because even if they go as they went in this example, yes, your buy trades will be stopped. At least just the part of them you left on the market, but your sell trades will cover the losses and will give you additional profit because the move is very strong. But this can be applied only to if the market is expecting, how to say it, very, very important news. It cannot be applied all the time, and you need to have a range and so on and so on. I won't go any more in depth regarding that.
And there is a lot of advanced strategy that we will not be able to speak about, but if you know about hedging, you know, in a range you can buy and sell at the same time, and then you keep one of them and you close, you know, you buy low and you sell high, you remove your stop loss, and then you just wait, and whatever happens, you take a decision, you close the losing trade, and that's all. Okay, another question? Yeah.
I have a question actually. You were saying earlier that it's good to develop, to not change the strategy too often, but it's also good to
super hard when you are alone. This is why I lost 4 years of my life. This is why you need a mentor. A mentor is not someone that is teaching you trading. It's someone who can tell you are on the good direction, you are on the wrong direction. There is an image that I used to use. It's an image of someone mining underground. So the guy is mining here. And here there is a diamond. But because the guy is alone, he's digging and digging and digging, but he's persisting, but then finally he give up and he go to dig elsewhere. He didn't know that actually he was super close to find the diamond. A mentor or a group can tell you, hey, the diamonds are close, keep going. So it's super hard when you are alone, it's easier when you are helped. Okay, so thanks. As I said, next time will be next Wednesday, same hour, same place. And we're going to go over charts and cycles and candles and so on. Thanks, everyone.